Good morning, students. It's my pleasure to meet you all in this August online forum. Myself, Dr. K. Ramasamy, working as a college librarian at M.E. Muthiah Government Arts College for Women, Dindukal, Tamil Nadu. On the outset, let me take this opportunity to thank the organizers, especially Organizing Secretary Dr. Raja sir, for having given me this wonderful opportunity of meeting you all. I'm going to discuss about Unit 5, Knowledge Organization, which consists of 10 different components: Universe of Knowledge, Knowledge Organization Classification, Mapping of Subjects in Library Classification Schemes, Knowledge Organization Cataloging, Standards of Bibliographic Record Formats and Description, Standards for Bibliographic Information Interchange and Communication, Metadata Standards, Indexing Systems and Techniques, Abstracting, and finally, Information Retrieval System. So let me begin with Unit 5.1, Universe of Knowledge. So dear friends, you know, basically librarians are concerned with the acquiring, processing, organizing, storing, and preserving knowledge in all kinds of formats, whether a physical format or e-format. We bother more about the organization and preservation of knowledge for posterity, that is, for the forthcoming generations to use it. So how does this knowledge get developed? See, basically we have data, the unprocessed bits of information, data. In the course of time, the data is converted into information when you process it. The processed information, the valid data, the meaningful data, used for a good number of time in wider communities, becomes knowledge in the course of time. The knowledge becomes wisdom in the long run. As a librarian, we bother about the knowledge, its organization, and its preservation. See, there is a study called epistemology, which talks about classification of knowledge. It is a special field of studies where they talk about origin, source, and nature of knowledge. I remember the quote given by Samuel Johnson, who said that knowledge is of two kinds. That is, either we know something, when somebody come and ask for some information, we know it. Otherwise, we know where we can find information about it. I think that is basically the role of librarian. When readers come to library and ask for some information, we are able to exactly give them what they want. Otherwise, at least we are able to tell them where they can find the information they are in need of. Good. So this knowledge, we talk about universe of knowledge. We talk about knowledge. There are two definitions. Dr. S.R. Ranganathan says that knowledge is nothing but the total of information conserved by civilization, starting from the Stone Age and Aryan civilizations, Indus Valley civilizations, till today, the total of the information which is conserved, which is preserved, which is taken care by the entire civilization is called as knowledge. Knowledge is a total of whatever we know and whatever we don't know. Whatever we know, we are able to record it, we are able to preserve it. And knowledge is nothing but the creation of human mind. Human mind, throughout the period, we keep on finding out something new and new and new. And this accumulated information or findings, discoveries, get accumulated in the form of knowledge. So a totality of what is known by all of us throughout the centuries is termed as knowledge. Fine. And what is the feature of this knowledge, the totality of knowledge called universe of knowledge? So universe of knowledge is having following qualities. It is infinite in the sense the knowledge keeps on growing. See, whatever we know already is infinite. See, nobody can say that I know everything. So whatever is known is infinite. And whatever is yet to be known is also infinite. So knowledge keeps on growing. And continuum, what is continuum? There is a continuity. You take any field, well, physics, chemistry, biology, botany, you take any field, every field has got continuity. It grows from one point to another point. The knowledge is turbulently dynamic. That means when the knowledge grows, there's a lot of new micro thoughts. Every new microphone, every new cell phone has got at least one or two added features. So in every bit of knowledge we develop, we receive afresh, has got something new. And knowledge is multi-folder, multi-dimensional and many-folder. That means whenever you want to analyze a particular issue these days, you can analyze a particular concept from many angles, from the points of view of many subjects. So the information starts becoming available in multi-dimensional modes. It's cumulative. See, always whenever a new knowledge comes, it is based on the old knowledge. So based on what is already known and what is already available, people start building new knowledge on the top of the existing knowledge. So the new knowledge is gradually and slowly getting accumulated. And finally, the universe of knowledge is multidirectional. So it doesn't grow in a unidirectional way. It grows in all directions. And variety of modes of formation of subjects are there, thanks to the growing knowledge. Then comes modes of formation of subjects. So when we see that knowledge is developing in all the ways, turbulently, continuously, in multi-dimensions, this knowledge which is developing into various subjects like physics, chemistry, biology, botany, how these subjects are formed, what are the various modes of formation of these subjects. So here is a list of modes of formation of subjects. Let us see one by one. Fission, you know, fission means dividing. We are going to divide a particular subject, a broader subject, so that we will get lot of smaller subjects. For example, if it is the entire universe of knowledge, it can be divided into broader categories like natural sciences, arts, humanities, and social sciences. Or if it is economics, it can be divided into small subjects like labor, economics, monetary economics, money and banking. So Fisher means dividing into two or three or four, dividing. And this fission can take place either in the form of dissection or denudation. See, both are fissions. But what is the difference between this dissection and denudation? In the case of dissection, the resulting entities will be coordinate in nature. For example, you take a subject called libraries, you divide them, the resulting entities are public libraries, academic libraries, special libraries. So all these things are on the same level. They are coordinate to each other. And if you divide academic libraries into school libraries, college libraries, and university libraries, then school, college, and university libraries are coordinate. So when you divide a particular topic, the results are nothing but a set of entities which are having equal status, which are coordinate to each other. Then we say that kind of fission is dissection. Good. Then what is denotation? So once again, this is a fission. When a subject is divided, the resulting answer will be in the form of a chain. What is a chain? One inside the other. One broader term, then one narrow term, then very, very narrow term. It goes this way. For example, you take education, then we have adult education, then we have literates. If you take Asia, then we have India, then we have Tamil Nadu. Here, we are moving from a very general broader topic to a narrow topic. So this kind of fission is called as denotation. Then comes lamination. So lamination means, you know very well, when you go to a shop to get your certificate laminated, no? What they do is that they keep a certificate, and over and under the certificate, they keep a plastic cover and they laminate. The same way, when one subject gets laminated over the other subject, you get a lot of new subjects, new modes of subjects are there. So this kind of formation is called lamination. For example, we have library science, a subject. We have India. When India is joined with library science, and that becomes subject, library science India. We have Ayurveda subject. We have a child. When child becomes a part of Ayurvedic system, it becomes a new subject called treatment of children in Ayurveda. Agriculture plus corn. So these two concepts are laminated to each other and we get laminated subjects. And basically, loose assemblage is a process where we are going to link together different topics, different subjects, different entities. When you have two different items, you are going to study the relationship that exists between these two items, then you get loose assemblage. See, basically, loose assemblage is categorized into three ideas. Loose assemblage 1, loose assemblage 2, and loose assemblage 3. So it's nothing but the phase relation what you study in colon classification. In loose assemblage 1, we take two subjects, physics, chemistry, library science, mathematics, and we study the relationship that exists between two major subjects. This is also called inter-subject phase relation. For example, difference between physics and chemistry. So physics and chemistry both are two different main classes. Influence of sociology on law. Sociology is one main class, law is another main class. Then we have influence of sociology and law. Yeah, result of loose assemblage mode of formation of subject. Here we are talking about two main classes and the relationship that exists between these two main classes. Good. Then comes loose assemblage 2. Here we take only one main class. Inside one main class, we take any one fundamental category, maybe personality, maybe matter, maybe energy. And inside personality, you take any two items, any two identifiers, any two items. If you study the relationship between these two items found under a single category of a single main class, that is called as intra-schedule phase relation or intra-phased phase relation. Intra-schedule means within one schedule. You go to one main class, you go to personality, you take any two items, you study a relationship between them. Maybe comparison, maybe difference, maybe bias, maybe influencing, maybe two relation, whatever it may be. For example, relation between Jainism and Buddhism. So Jainism and Buddhism both are personality phases found in the main class called religion. Comparison between Shakespeare and Bernard Shaw. So both are the authors. Both are the personality facets of literature main class. So you study about two different isolated ideas, which are part and parcel of a single fundamental category of a single main class. Fine. Then comes loose assemblage 3. Here, you go to a single main class. You go to a single fundamental category, be personality or matter, energy. If you go to personality facet, personality fundamental category, there, you take a single array. Single array. For example, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Single array. Or 2, 1, 2, 2, 2, 3, 2, 4, 2, 5, 2, 6, 2, 7, 2, 8, 2, 9. So another array. You take any one array and any two isolated ideas taken from the single array will be studied. The relationship between the ideas taken from the single array of single fundamental category of single main class. So that is called as intra-array phase relation. For example, relation between UDC and DDC, difference between rural people and city people. So these are loose assemblage 3. So here you can see in colon classification, there is a table, phase relation table. You can see here, kinds of phase relation, general, bias, comparison, difference, tool and influencing. Three different kinds of loose assemblage formations. This is loose assemblage 1, loose assemblage 2, and loose assemblage 3. Dr. S. R. Ranganathan has prescribed the punctuation marks for each and every kind of phase relation, for each and every kind of loose assemblage. For example, if you have a subject where you are comparing two main classes, comparison, two main classes, you have to make use of the connecting symbol called C. If you are studying the comparative relationship between two items taken from single main class, single fundamental category, you will make use of M. If you've taken two ideas from the same array of a same fundamental category of a same main class, you'll make use of V. You can please remember these indicator digits, because some examination they ask. They give to match the following column. They'll ask you to match which symbol will be used for denoting which kind of relationship. Good. Then comes fusion. So as you know, nuclear fission and fusion is a fusion where you're going to combine, you're going to merge two or three subjects together to form a new subject. For example, biochemistry, geophysics, astrophysics, education psychology, geopolitics. So the beauty with the fusion is that when two subjects are fused together, each subject loses its individuality. So each one will lose their uniqueness, and the unique features of both the subjects will be merged together to form a new subject. That is the beauty of fusion. Good. Then comes distillation. It's a new kind of formation of subject wherein a particular concept which appears in many subjects in the course of time becomes established itself as a new subject. For example, you take management. See, management of physical laboratories, management of industries, management of hospitals, management of animals, management of human beings, management of highly affected people. So management is there everywhere. Research methodology, research is there everywhere. You can do research in any subject. So these kinds of subjects like management and research methodology, they appear in a good number of main subjects. In the course of time, they themselves become a new subject. So that process is called as distillation. Then comes agglomeration. Whenever you're having 3 or 4 or 5 or 6 continuous main classes, continuous basis subjects, related basis subjects, when these subjects are studied together under a broader heading, that is called as agglomeration. For example, we have biological sciences, social sciences, physical sciences, and etc. Then comes cluster, which is also known as subject bundle. Here, we are going to take a single concept, and that concept will be studied from 360 angles. So all the points of view of a particular concept will be studied in detail. For example, we have area studies called Indology. Indology is a subject where we talk about all aspects of India. Political aspect, cultural aspect, economic aspect, spiritual aspect. So all aspects of India are covered. Nipponology, study of Japan. The same way we have generally a person study. So we have something called Gandhiana, where all aspects of Gandhiji will be studied. His nature, his qualities, personal qualities, his political interests, his economical reforms, books written by him, his ideas on education, his ideas on children, his ideas on women. So all kinds of things about Gandhiji will be studied. That is called Gandhiana. Then comes entity or phenomena study, where we take a single concept like soils or surface or space or ocean or defense, and we study everything about it. For example, if you take space science, we start from what kind of dress they should have, what kind of food they should have, what kind of psychology they should have, what kind of education they should have, what kind of biological safety measures they should have, what kind of weapons they should have. See, all these kinds of things about space is studied. Fine. So everything about a particular subject studied 360 degree angle. So that is called as cluster or subject bundle. Good. So all these methods can be broadly classified into three categories: modes of growth of subjects by specialization. Maybe you can have denotation, dissection, and lamination over there. Then we have interdisciplinary mode. There we have loose assemblage, where we talk about two different subjects. Then fusion, again, we have two different subjects. Then we have multidisciplinary. We have distillation. A subject appears in many subjects. Then agglomeration, many subjects are bundled together. Then subject bundles, we study everything about a single concept. So these are method of classifying all these modes of formation of subjects. If you talk in general, the structure of modes of formation of subject, we have dichotomy, we have dichotomy, we have polychotomy. We talk about dichotomy, we divide each and every subject into two at every stage. You take a subject, divide into two, and each of the two concepts will be further divided into two and two. This way, it keeps on going. So that kind of structure is called as dichotomy. And the tree of profile is a schematic representation dichotomy. So two into two into two, 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 that kind of structure is called as tree of profile. Then dichotomy, as Melville Dewey adopted for his classification, it is dividing a particular thing into 10. Then each of the 10 will be again divided into 10 each. So 10, 10, 10, it goes. It's dichotomy. Polychotomy is a Ranganathan's. Each and every concept can be divided into as many items as you require for your particular subject. Fine. Okay. Then. So, if you see what is a basis for the people to map the universe of knowledge. So, we have to map them. So, we have seen what is knowledge. And we have seen what is universe of knowledge. And what are the characteristics of universe of knowledge. And how various subjects are getting evolved. See, how we are going to organize and arrange all these subjects. How are you going to map the universe of knowledge? So many principles are there. Long back, we had ideological principle where people started organizing and mapping the universe of knowledge based on some ideological principles. For example, they have Christian schemes where they have Christianity-based classification. If you take Russian schemes, they have based their classifications on Marxism and Leninism as the center of the universe. Then later on, we have social purpose, how the life is. For example, during the Vedic period, the entire universe of knowledge was divided into four categories called Dharma, Ad, Kama, and Moksha. So, fine. So, they have divided the knowledge into four groups. Bit later, when library scientists have started taking over the process of mapping the universe of knowledge, there's a group of people, they had followed scientific order. So they had their own natural and logical order of subjects. For example, Charles Amicutter, he emphasized on arranging the subjects based on their evolution, how subjects are or have evolved over a period of time. So based on the evolution of subjects, you have to arrange subjects. The same thing was followed even in Library of Congress classification. Then later on, of late, we have principle of arrangement by discipline. So people have started arranging all subjects based on the discipline. For example, Francis Bacon, he has given this particular order, history, then arts, then social science. When Melville Dewey started arranging his schema classification, he followed the inverted pattern of Francis Bacon's scheme of arrangement. So of late, at present, we have this particular method called arrangement of subjects by discipline. Good. So 5.1 is over. Now let us go to 5.2 and 5.3. Here two items are there. One is knowledge organization classification. Then comes mapping of subjects in library classification schemes, DDC, UDC, and CC. Fine. Okay. I think we'll get into this. So before we proceed further, let us understand what is knowledge organization clearly. So please understand, knowledge organization is nothing but the description of documents. Fine. See, we have got a lot of documents in the library. Whenever readers come to the library asking for these documents, we should be able to make these documents accessible by them. How to have these particular set of documents available in the library accessible to the users? We are going to describe them. Each and every document, what you are going to have in the library is going to be described. Their features, their purposes are going to be described. And these descriptions will be organized in such a manner that the readers will be able to go and retrieve what they exactly want. For example, you prepare indexes, you prepare abstracts, you prepare cataloging entries, you prepare and arrange your books on the base of a classification system, you have proper records management procedures, you prepare bibliography on various subjects, you prepare either textual or bibliographical databases. See, all these are different methods that can be employed by you to describe the resources what you have in the library. So knowledge organization is nothing but we have the knowledge. The knowledge is to be organized. To organize the knowledge, you use all these different methods so that the resources in the library will be described and these descriptions will be organized properly. Good? Okay. Then what is knowledge organization system? So it means everything. It means all types of schemes. Whatever method, whatever technology you follow in libraries for the purpose of organizing the information, for the purpose of enabling you to have a better knowledgement practices, all those schemes are called as knowledge organization systems. For example, we have classification schemes that help you to arrange the books based on their subjects in the shelves. We have subject headings from which we are able to choose the keywords to describe the subject content of the books and other documents. We have authority files, which are maintained in each and every library that takes control of local variations. So whenever you feel that there is a name peculiar to your place, so there are places which are peculiar to your organization, so you can have an authority file in your library. Apart from these traditional methods like classification schemes, subject headings, and authority files, we have modern schemes, less traditional schemes like semantic networks, ontologies, taxonomies, foxonomy, all those things. So all these things are called as knowledge organization systems. Fine. And what are the different types of knowledge organization systems we have? One is term lists, a category where they will be listing only the key terms. See, we would like to have only a very few selected list of terms that can be used for all our purposes in libraries. So that's a kind of controlled vocabulary listing of terms. It may be an authority file, it can be a glossary, it can be a dictionary, or it can be a gazette, it can be anything of that sort. Then comes classification schemes and other categories called, we have subject headings like Library of Congress subject headings, we have Sears list of subject headings, we have medical subject headings, and we have a lot of classification schemes starting from long back. We had many schemes like Riders, International Classification, Colon Classification, Dewey Decimal Classification, Subject Classification, Bibliographic Classification, Expansive Classification. So all these classification schemes, taxonomies, categorization schemes, all kinds of schemes meant for categorizing the subjects. Then comes a relationship list where we arrange the keywords. Not only that, we establish the semantic relationship that exists between the keywords. For example, we have thesaurus, we have semantic networks, we have ontologies, where we show not only the ordered preferred terms, along with that, we provide the relationship like broader term, narrower term, greater term, equivalent term. All those things are also available there. Good. Okay. So first, let us talk about knowledge organization classification schemes. See, basically, when you talk about knowledge organization, the first thing what strikes your mind is classification. People say that classification is it's almost equal to the term organization of knowledge. Fine, because classification is the knowledge organization scheme that helps us to pinpoint specific and precisely defined items of information. Whenever users come to library, they come and ask for some information like, sir, I want some information on book selection. You can immediately tell them, please go to 2:53. Very simple. So I want some information on Raman effect. You go to C4:35. So exactly, pinpointly, you can say that where a particular piece of specific information is available. Apart from that, you can tell the users, you can tell them where a complete range of subjects are also available. You can tell them, you go to second row, third cupboard, the entire cupboard is meant for electronics. So entire range of resources on a particular subject can also be identified using classification schemes. So what is the role of a classification scheme? Very simple. Classification scheme will help you to arrange subjects in a linear sequence in an order, starting from A to Z, starting from 001 to 99, and all the subjects will be arranged in a linear scale. A scheme which will be helpful to most of the users. Okay, one classification claims that A to Z is the best way of arranging subjects. DDC claims that 00 to 99 is the best way of organizing resources in the library. So what would it be? So one is classification schemes help you to arrange subjects in a linear sequence. And secondly, the main purpose of using any classification scheme is to mechanize the arrangement. What is mechanizing? Instead of telling the people you go to second row, third cupboard, we simply tell them go to C4. Go to 535, go to 020. So this way we started mechanizing, we started giving artificial numbers to the subject content of the books, right? It's a major purpose of any classification scheme. What are the various classification schemes available? The slide shows you name of the scheme, developer, and year of the development of that particular scheme. So Dewey Decimal Classification, maybe we'll do 1876. Expansive Classification, Cutter. Adjustable Classification, J.D. Brown. Library of Congress Classification from Library of Congress. Universal Decimal Classification from Paul Artlett and Henry LaFontaine, the advocates. Subject Classification from J.D. Brown. So J.D. Brown has got two kinds of classifications developed by him. Colon Classification, Dr. S.R.R., we know. Bibliographic Classification, H.E. Bliss. Riders, International Classification by Fremont Rider. Broad System Ordering by UNICEST, UNESCO, FIDE, Combined Effort. Fine. So the development of various classification over a period of time can be categorically placed under three distinct periods. The first period is called as pre-phased period, 1876 to 1896, where we had schemes like DDC and expansive classification, where the classificationist and classifiers, they just started enumerating all the subjects without having any facets, without having any fundamental categories. Then comes a transition to facet period, the Library of Congress classification and the Universal Decimal Classification, where they thought of introducing some kind of categories. Then facet period, 1933 to 1972, there we have colon classification, bibliographic classification, and Riders International Classification. So where they started arranging the components of every subject under different categories. For example, if you take Ranganathan, we have personality, matter, energy, space, and time. That way, they started arranging the components, isolate ideas into facets. Fine. So let's begin with colon classification. The first edition was published in 1933. It was in three parts, and they used mixed notation. And for all the places, they used only colon as the connecting symbol. That is why it was called as colon classification. Second edition was published in 1939. And Ranganathan introduced two devices in second edition, octave principles and auto bias device. See, octave principle means if you take an array, it will go from 1 to 8. After 1 to 8, the sector will be over. The next sector will start from 1, 9. After 1, 1, 1, 2, for example, you divide a particular concept into many categories. We start from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. After 8, you start from 9, 9, 1, 9 will not be there. 9, 1, 9, 2, 9 will be there. So that way you keep on continuing. So that's called active principles. 8, not more than 8. Then the subject spiritual experience and mysticism was added in second edition. And in second edition, we had a fourth part. Apart from three parts, first part rules, second part schedules, third part index. Fourth part, they had provided 3,000 examples in second edition. Third edition, which was published 1950, it was based on dynamic theory of classification. It was based on the postulate of fundamental categories. It is the first time where Ranganathan introduced the concept of postulates of fundamental categories. And each fundamental category, personality, matter, energy, space, and time, was assigned a separate indicator digit, not colon for all. But then also, they used only one single punctuation mark called dot for both time and energy. Fine. So the fourth edition was published in 1952. There, the indicator digit connecting symbol for time was changed from dot to single inverted comma. And only in edition 4, many Greek letters were also added by Dr. S. R. Ranganathan. Then fifth edition, where they introduced the second level of space and time. See, space and time, they'll have first level and second level. For example, if you take time, 1979 is the first level, and the second level of time can be daytime or night time, winter time, something like that. If you take space, the first level will be countries, America, India, Pakistan, and all. Second level space can be something like rivers, valleys, mountains, deserts. So this kind of second level was introduced in edition 5. And sixth edition was published in 1960. Wherein Ranganathan introduced three chapters, chapter 6, 7, and 8. And that is the edition which had seen the birth of a separate schedule for phase relation. It was reprinted again in 1963. And seventh edition was published in 1987. Only volume 1 was published. Volume 2 and index are not published till date. Fine. So colon classification is also called as analytico-synthetic scheme, because it involved two steps, analysis and synthesis. When you receive a book, you analyze what are the various components. What is the main class? What is P? What is M? What is E? What is S? What is T? Then you synthesize by using connecting symbols. You merge all main class and all the P, M, E, S, T. Then you look class number. So colon classification is called as analytico-synthetic scheme. How the subjects are mapped in colon classification, you can see here. They are sciences, A to M. Then we have humanities, N to S. Then we have social sciences, T to Z. In between, we have got two subjects called mysticism and spiritual experience. Then we have general classes, A to Z. Then 1 to 9. So these are the subjects enumerated by Dr. S. R. Ranganathan. Main classes, what you see in colon classification, 6th edition. Good. The 7th edition of colon classification, which was published in 1987, only one first volume was published. The volume 1 was divided into 5 parts, part A to part E. And each of these parts were further divided into several chapters. So part A talks about introduction, part B about guidance to beginner, part C general rules, part D general divisions and common isolates, and part E, special isolates. And apart from that, in the 7th edition, Dr. S. R. Ranganathan introduced new indicator digits like ampersand symbol, plus symbol, equal symbol, asterisk mark, and double quotes. And 7th edition had 26 traditional main subjects and 776 basic subjects. And the fundamental category matter was divided into 3. The 7th edition, we have matter method, matter property, and matter material. And so, you know, in 6th edition, whenever you want to denote an anteriorizing common isolate, we were using indicator digit, a Roman small letters. But 7th edition, they replaced it with a double inverted comma. And in 6th edition, we are using 0 as a connecting symbol for all phase relation related subjects. But in 7th edition, they replaced the symbol 0 with ampersand symbol. And in fact, 7th edition is based on the 3rd edition of Proligomena to Library Classification, the latest version of Dynamic Theory of Library Classification. Good. And Dr. S. R. Ranganathan has utter that, you have n number of entities, isolates in n number of subjects. But any isolate, any entity in any subject can be conveniently categorized under any one of these five fundamental categories. There are only five. P, M, E, S, T. Personality, the core of any subject. Matter, then energy, the process, action, everything. Space, then time. And what is the order? P, M, E, S, T. Fine. I think it's clear to you. A question comes here. Sir, when there is only one P, only one M, there is only one E, there is only one S, one T is no problem. We can arrange the entities in this particular order. Main class number followed by P, M, E, S, T. In a case, in a particular subject, you have more than one P, more than one M, more than one E. What to do? There are two personalities in a single title, two matter items, two energies. What to do? So Ranganathan has given the principles of facet sequence. Okay. So this can be used to arrange two personalities, two matters, or two energy isolates. For example, there is a subject called diagnosis of disease. So both are energy facets. Diagnosis is energy facets. Disease also energy facets. Both these two energy facets appear in a single title. Now, how can I decide whether I should give number for disease first or diagnosis first? This way, whenever such a confusion arises, make use of the principles of facet sequence. For example, wall picture principle. So unless there is a wall, picture cannot be drawn over there. Unless there is a disease, unless there is a diagnosis, we cannot find the disease. So first diagnosis, then disease. The same way, you take Hindi drama, two items are there. First Hindi, then drama. See, if Hindi is not there, Hindi drama will not be there. So Hindi first, drama second. So wall picture principle. And apart from this, Ranganathan has given some more principles, which are the corollaries of wall picture principle. Corollaries means whether you are using wall picture principle or you are using any three of these principles, both will give the same answer. Both will give the same order of subjects to be placed in a particular classification scheme. For example, you take two concepts like judiciary of India. So we can follow whole organ principle. What is whole? India is whole. What is organ? Judiciary. Judiciary is a part of India. So when you're going to give the number, India will get first number, then judiciary gets second number. Then comes cow calf principle. So you know very well in villages, whenever people are selling cow, if there is a milching baby, there's a milching baby, they will sell both the mother and the milching baby together. They will not sell separately. The same way, whenever some concepts appear in a particular title, these concepts ought to be kept together following the policy of cow calf principle. They should always move together. Mother cow and baby cow will always go together. For example, you take India constitution, local body rules. So India first, then constitution, India's constitution, then constitution of local bodies. They will go together hand by hand. Then comes act and actor tool principle. Here, when you got many different items, the components can be arranged based on this particular rule. What is the actant? What is the actant? The core material on which the entire process takes place. So what is the actant here? Silk. Because everything revolves around silk here. So silk is the actant. Then comes action. What is action? Spinning is action. What is the tool? Machine is the tool. Fine. So actant is silk, action is spinning, actor is youth, tool is machine. In this order, you have to arrange. So these principles of facet sequence will help you to arrange when you have more than one personality or one matter or one energy in a single title. Good? Yes. So I think I wind up the first part of my session here, and I will talk about the remaining portion of 5.2 and 5.3 in my next presentation. So thank you so much. Make a note of your doubts and we'll discuss in a separate session. Thank you so much.